I'm going to go ahead and introduce our two speakers tonight. The reason we have been doing this is we're finding that with our community physicians, you know, there's a lot coming down the road on MACRA, along with a lot of other things too, right? So the really good news about tonight, at least to my knowledge, is actually we're not talking about the election, right? So we're not talking about the race, unless you want to Google in Saturday Night Live, a cold start from last night. But sometimes it's good to know from our experts that, you know, what's coming, you can ask all the questions you want, and we're not trying to sell you consulting services, right? So it's feel free to ask away. We've got some really smart people in the room. So I'll introduce them first. Dr. Andy Bland, he's our Chief Medical Officer for Quality for the Med Group. Brilliant man, frankly, when it comes to quality. And when I've talked, when he and I talk about population health and what we're trying to get done, whether it's RAF scores or whatever, Medicare Advantage plans, absolutely on the cutting edge. And so we didn't have to go far to find him. So Andy, thanks for being here tonight. And then Dan Hooten is our Vice President of Managed Care for the entire HSHS system. Dan came to us a few years ago from Cigna, where he worked for Cigna. So he came back from the dark side and decided to come work with the professionals. And but Dan, if you want to know what's going on in managed care, he's going to cover some stuff on MACRA. But if you have any other questions on what's coming down the line in managed care, ask him why you got him tonight, because the guy is knows everything on that. So, and I've got him on speed dial. So. That's how important it is. So with that, Andy, I'm going to turn it over to you. And everyone, enjoy your meal tonight. Thanks for making it.
Good evening. My name is Andy Bland, and by training, I am med peds and adult nephrology. And that wasn't nerdy enough, so I decided to get in and do the esoteric work in quality. So celebrating my nerddom, we put this together. And because I like some of the shows like CSI, et cetera, try to put this in terms of how you can understand what's going on with CMS and how they're thinking. And so talking a little bit about what the missing piece is, what is CMS actually searching for? Because I've heard some talk in the room that CMS is constantly changing their mind. They are. But if you understand how they're thinking, you can actually understand the decisions they're making and potentially anticipate some of those down the way, because they have a one overarching piece that they're really looking for. Talk a little bit about the motive of why they're doing this, the means, and then the opportunity that sits behind this. And then Dan will talk about MIPS and MACRA, how that fits together. And then we'll try to tie it up by actually providing you and showing you solutions. Because one of the things that I hear a lot is that no one knows how to solve these problems. And what I want to show you a little bit is how we're thinking about solving them, and then try to talk you through some ways that if you're trying to solve these on your own, some questions that you can ask as you begin looking at this, or questions that you can ask other people as you begin talking about alliances. In tribute to my nerddom, the wireless presenter didn't come, and so I'm using my phone. Who knows, this is the first time I ever use it, so it may break. We may go back to the old school where I do the film strip and Dan advances
and push the button.
Switch back and forth. Feel free to interrupt and ask questions at any time. All right, so what's CMS missing? What are they looking for? And it's value. And CMS really looks at value as the numerator and denominator. It's like just every quality indicator you have. And so if you take a look at this is quality. CMS recognizes that most of its quality measures are process measures. They're moving towards outcome measures, but that's a lot harder than you may think. And then service. The service piece are the CG caps and H caps that you hear about. And so the numerator for value is quality plus service. What CMS is also looking at is the bottom part, and that is cost. And so what they're saying is healthcare is awfully costly. And then they multiply this by risk. And this is why you hear CMS talking all the time about shifting risk to the providers. And the reason is because as they look at the amount of risk they're taking, they feel it's excessive. And so a good value is something that improves quality and service and reduces cost and risk. And if you look at the denominator, it's cost times risk. And so the denominator increases or decreases much faster than the numerator does. And so this is why you see a lot of concern about dollars spent in healthcare. So what is this? This is from OECD, which is a neutral world organization that's looking at statistics for healthcare spending as percent of GDP. This line right here is us, it's the United States. It's now 16.9% of our GDP. This is the rest of the world. And you're welcome to go to OECD.org and you can actually plug in whatever countries you want to replicate this data. This is the reason that CMS is saying we need value. We're not seeing improved outcomes for increased costs. Why do they say that? They're saying part of this is fee-for-service reimbursement. Part of this is fragmentation in care delivery. All of us know one of the biggest frustrations I have as a healthcare professional is having to swim upstream to do the right thing. As a nephrologist, if I do something, I have to make 4 phone calls to really do the right thing. You know, because nephrology and cardiology, they love to fight about Lasix. Nephrology loves, say if you want things to get better, turn down the Lasix. Cardiology says, well, if you want heart failure to get better, you gotta turn up the Lasix. And we leave you in the middle trying to figure out which one of us is right. Well, it's us. But, yeah, and I told that to Prairie, the folks at Prairie. It puts a huge burden on you if I'm not willing to cooperate and explain my reasoning to you. Administrative burden, they do recognize that we spend more time doing paperwork and sitting in front of a computer than we should. The population is getting older. Because of that, you see a rising rate of chronic disease, also contributing our lifestyle factors and personal health choices. Advances in medical technology. There's a piece of medical technology that costs $30,000 that will monitor, that's implantable, and will monitor your CHF patient's CVP and tell you whether or not they're at risk for heart failure. I think you can get similar outcomes for about $7.04. But technology is really cool. And so if you have technology that doesn't increase quality while increasing cost, it lowers the value. Lack of cost transparency. How many of you know how much a CT scan costs at St. Elizabeth's? This is everywhere. And so we need to spend more time talking about this so that patients understand what they have to do. And then the healthcare legal and regulatory environment is overly burdensome. And so, believe it or not, I had the chance to meet with Andy Slavik, and he believes that MACRA is actually simpler than the other programs that are out there that are combined. He feels that it's reducing the paperwork burden. So how is CMS doing this? What are the means that they're using? And they're emphasizing value. One of the places that I want to call this to is everybody talks about what's happening now is a move to capitation. CMS does not see this as a move to capitation. They recognize that capitation is broken. And what they say is part of the reason is that they recognize the same thing that we've been saying forever, is that there's a penalty for taking sick patients in capitation. Capitation doesn't work because it's cherry picking and punishes those who you try to care for the most ill. They say, we don't want capitation, even though it meets several of these. Yes, it meets. You can see fee for service. What they say is you do more. And so one of the places I would actually take you to look at is if you look at West Texas and the cardiology costs and rate of cardiac catheterization and stent placement in West Texas, you will find that it is 3 standard deviations ahead of the rest of the country. And the reason is that it's 3 standard deviations ahead of the rest of the country and the number of cardiologists that actually practice there. Has nothing to do with coronary artery incidence rate. And so fee-for-service does not discourage unnecessary episodes. It doesn't bundle things together. And it doesn't encourage coordination, doesn't facilitate cost comparison. It doesn't encourage high-quality services. I'll be honest, when I was in private practice, we would sit around the table and talk about, well, if we prevent readmissions, we're actually making it harder for ourselves to impact our own bottom line. We had that conversation when I was a partner in the group. It made me very uncomfortable to have the conversation to recognize that I could increase my bottom line or do the right thing for patients. And that's a really hard place to be. Some of you, I'm sure, feel some of that same tension. And so you wonder how to align these. Episode of care. So this is, these are the bundles. These are the joint bundles, et cetera. They discourage unnecessary services, yes. Do they pay for all the services? Yes. They don't discourage unnecessary episodes. What they're talking about is something called comprehensive payment. And the question you may ask is, how do you avoid taking penalty for sicker patients? How many of you have heard of HCC scores? Any of you? But we'll talk some about this. So the RAF score is one of the ways that this happens, that you actually get this, and I'll go through some examples when we get to the opportunity section. So this is what CMS plans on doing. This comes out of bipartisan thought leadership. This is the CMS glide path. They're saying fee for service without link for quality, we're getting rid of this in category one. Category two, we're linking this. This is the value-based modifier. How many of you are participating in PQRS? How many of you are participating in the value modifier? Probably you are, because if you're not, you're paying a penalty at CMS by this point, if you're not. How many of you have ever seen your QRUR before? Never heard of a QRUR before? If you're participating in PQRS, you're sending your data to CMS. CMS is aggregating that data, and every year in September, they release the previous year. So in September of 16, they're releasing the 15 results. And your group, your TIN, tax identification number, is plotted on a double axis of quality and cost. And within that quality and cost, you're ranked. It's available. All you have to do is go to QualityNet. I would encourage you, if you have never seen your QRUR, to go get it. Why? Because where you're placed in your QRUR gives you a very good sense of how you're going to do in MIPS for at least the next 2 years. Right now, the QRUR says if you're in the minus one to plus one standard deviation, there's no payment penalty. So 68% of us are not going to get paid, are not going to have a payment penalty or get additional payment. So that would be one takeaway from this evening, is taking a look at your QRUR. These are alternative payment models. These are what's called APMs, based on fee for service. These are ACOs, track one, track two, Pioneer, Medical Homes. How many of you have heard of CPC Plus? Comprehensive Primary Care Plus. This would be something that you would also, this one is actually an advanced alternative payment model, and I'm priming the pumps for Dan as he goes through the alphabet soup of MACRA. And then bundled payments. I expect that bundled payments, so there's actually another rule out for comment right now, which is the bundled payment rule. They're actually turning these payments into advanced alternative payment models. They've not officially become that yet, so you can't say that they are, but one of the big cries within the MACRA, within the initial rule of the 1,000 pages of the MACRA rule, was they're actually begging for feedback on how to turn these bundles into advanced alternative payment models so that you can get out of MIPS. This is MIPS. This is pushing you to MIPS. This is where they want everybody to go, which is population-based risk management.
Could you describe what those acronyms are, like MACRA, MIPS, and QRUR?
Actually, I'm going to have one whole slide of nothing but the acronyms.
But before you leave,
last year in 15, CMS announced they had a goal. They were going to have 30% of all their payment in category 2 and 3. Now, most people say they're not there yet, but CMS in April announced they've accomplished that goal. Now, they also have a goal that by 18, 50% of all their payments is going to be in one of those two categories. And their second goal is 85% of all payments are going to be tied to quality, which is 2, 3, and 4. By the end of 16, they haven't announced they've made it yet, but whatever they announce is the rule. And they'll have 90% of all the payments by the end of 18 in those three categories. So fee for service is dead in 2 years, is the basic takeaway. Andy?
All right, so one of the things that I want to show you here is how does all this fit together? And so there's category one, which is fee for service, category two. Category two is broken down into a glide path.
saying, first, we're going to pay you to improve your infrastructure. That program was called Meaningful Use. We're going to pay you to put computers in your office so and in the hospital so that we can begin looking at data. Now we're going to pay you to report to us this data, which is PQRS. Now we're going to reward you for performance, which is the value-based modifier based on PQRS. Now we're nearing the end of category two, which is rewards and penalties for performance, which is MIPS, which is combining those things together. So it's the merit-based incentive payment system, which is what MIPS stands for. Next, what they talk about is category three, and this is the APMs that are based on fee-for-service architecture. Here are some advanced APMs that I'm talking about, and I did put AMI, CJR, the cabbage bundle in here because I expect in the final comment rule, when the final rule for the bundled payments is released, these will all be advanced APMs. One of the big things that's changing right now is CMS recognizes it doesn't have enough advanced APMs. They are going to be making advanced APMs because advanced APMs make you immune to the downside of MIPS, because they want you to take risk. CPC Plus, Dan told me today on the drive down while he was reading his emails, is that he was writing, I was on top track. So.
That's because my section of this presentation was changing today,
yes.
So I had to do my homework, so I will be speaking from notes, because everything changed.
So the CPC Plus is actually a very interesting program. They actually give you a per member per month fee to build the infrastructure to build a medical home. Generally about $15 per member per month to be able to build the infrastructure. In the first round, there were no payers in Illinois that actually signed into this. They needed additional payers. Who knows what will happen in the 2018 round, but I think you'll begin seeing this. And so CPC Plus becomes very attractive if you're looking at this, because suddenly you're getting per member per month dollars to invest in infrastructure to change outcomes. So I would pay a lot of attention to CPC Plus. And then over here, this is the population health piece. You can see what I put down here is the Track 1 ACO. This is what some of us are in right now, is the non-risk, the non-downside risk. This is more of an APM with upside only. They're going to release something called ACO One Plus that will be an advanced APM, and part of being an advanced APM is having risk sharing. So they're going to take this and say, well, we'll also share risk with you, which sounds an awful lot like a track
two
ACO.
Or three.
But what CMS is doing is pushing into risk-based sharing. And over here is at-risk Medicare Advantage, not just regular Medicare Advantage, but actually sharing in the risk of it. So this goes back to what Dan was talking about. And so, again, the pieces that I wanted to talk about is we have MIPS, which is the glide path on track two, High Performance Network, which again is rewarding quality, the MSSP track one, ACO, upside risk only. I would think very hard about why you wouldn't get into a Track 1 ACO. The Track 1 ACO gives you MIPS scoring advantages, and it gives you access to something called fully adjudicated claims. Is that a term anybody's heard before today? So fully adjudicated claims is everything your patient has, their health plan has paid for, CMS has paid for. You can see colonoscopies, mammograms, you can see admissions, discharges, all of the things that happen to the patient across the entire continuum of care, you get that data. And you can get into a Track 1 ACO by joining other organizations and then having them help you with the population health piece. But I think you really want to think hard about being in a Track 1 ACO because it's an introduction to population health with relatively low risk. It allows you to put your toe in for people to tell you interesting things about what's happening with your patient, so you can begin looking at it, and then at-risk Medicare Advantage. So what is the opportunity here? One of the things, as an internist, that frustrates me is we get paid to do things, not think.
right? That's been the frustration. An E&M code for cabbage is like 44 RVUs. An E&M code for deciding someone should be referred to a cabbage is one. The RVUs currently for coordinating care, well, if you can get your patient to sign up for the CCM visit, it's like two RVUs. It's not very much. What this does is if you're actually looking at this and coding for your patients in terms of risk, is you may get rewarded for thinking about and coordinating your patient's care. So HCCs are these hierarchical categorical conditions, and they're used to predict costs for enrolled members. They use ICD-9 and ICD-10 codes to identify chronic illness. There are 9,000 ICD-10 codes that match the 79 HCC codes. There is no way any human being can memorize all these codes, the 79 HCCs, and figure it out. You need some sort of decision support to be able to help you with it. Each HCC is given a value, and then the sum of these HCCs is added to generate the RAF score. The thing that's very interesting about this RAF score is if you're in traditional Medicare Advantage, and your insurance company gets paid $800 times their RAF score times 12 per member. So if your normal RAF score is 1, so that's 800 times 12, that's $9,600 a year. If you have 1,000 patients, that's $96,000 a year that you have to manage those 1,000 patients entirely for the year. The thing that's interesting is this is the same person. This is the same 72-year-old, dual eligible, she's eligible for Medicaid as well, has diabetes with vascular complications, she has a little bit of CKD, she's had an MI that's caused her to have CHF. One of those rare patients that you never see. Right? And then there's the disease interaction that I was talking about is here's where you get extra credit for the cardiologist and nephrologist fighting. You get this disease interaction for diabetes, CHF, and renal failure. You get a total RAF of 2.447, which gives you $1,800 a month to be able to manage this patient. If you don't code for this, and you never see the patient, and they just get all their care in the emergency department in the hospital, you get a wonderful payment of $253 a month to care for this patient. If you do the typical EHR, where you don't think about these things as being ways to increase the resources available for you to care for this patient, you may end up with $627 or so a month. And you can see that this is three times the amount of resources available to care for the same patient. And so if you know how to do this, there's a way to really have resources available. Where do these resources go if you're not risk sharing? They go to the insurance company. But if you're risk sharing and you're able to do this, those scores come back to you, those dollars come back to you, and so you can invest in the infrastructure. What do you have to do? You have to meet the MEET criteria. So you have to MEET the MEAT criteria. So one of the big complaints about HCC scores I hear everybody say is the government assumes that their leg grew back every year because HCC scores reset. The government doesn't assume the leg grows back. What the government assumes is that if you don't monitor, manage, evaluate, assess, or treat, that they shouldn't be paying you because there's no risk. If you're not having to manage it, it's not a problem. That's not the way we think about documentation. We look at the stump, we say it's clean, we say that she's doing well with her prosthesis, and there's nothing else we need to do, but we don't document that in the chart. So we've actually made an assessment, we've evaluated and assessed and said there needs to be no change to treatment, we just don't document it. And if we do that, we can get credit for it. We do the intellectual work. It's just changing to say we need to actually get credit for it. Because there's no one who goes, come on. Do you really think the government thinks that people's legs grow back? Okay, well maybe. But it's that they want to make sure that you're actually taking the time to think about it. So this is a screenshot from a program called Clinovations. And what this is built within the EHR workflow to be able to document this
So this is a, this pulls the problem list, goes to the problem list, goes to the medication list. So it's the HCC that we need to address today is COPD. And what we need to know is which part of the MEET criteria are we looking at? Is it asymptomatic, continued current treatment, stable based on signs and symptoms, improving, worsening? And then it basically says see progress. Now, it doesn't say you have to double document, do all those things that are huge burdens when you have to do it in another EHR. There's ways to do this within the standard workflow that you get credit for. And then it creates a note. So what I'm going to do now is turn it over to Dan so that he can talk a little bit about MIPS and MACRA. Do you want my phone?
If you're willing to let me have it.
Otherwise, I'll stand up here and go beep.
I can't. Do it.
Okay. I'll go beep. You heard Andy talk about the 1,000 pages of legislation. Those were the proposed regulations that took about 170 pages of PowerPoints from CMS to explain. The final rules were over 2,200 pages of final regulations. And then, as I said this morning, they started adding to it. Hence my notes. So, I promised acronyms. They're not all up there. I think it's a little longer. But we'll make sure that you get all these acronyms so that you can have some understanding of what's going on. Meaningful use, the ACI, they changed the name so you don't recognize that it's going away. The alternative payment model is part of what Andy's been talking about. The advanced alternative payment model is also what Andy's been talking about a little bit. The clinical practice improvements, it's how MIPS is scored. If you try and figure out how it's scored, forget it, it's so complex. MACRA is what we're talking about. You know you're in trouble when they put an acronym in the acronym. And MIPS is part of it. That's half of this program. That's the merit-based incentive payment program. Now, when the proposed regulations came out, they thought somewhere between 4 and 12% of all the physicians would get into the alternative payment models. So they're trying to loosen that. They now think it's maybe 15 to 25% 5 years in. So they're trying to loosen it, and that was what was coming out today, was how they're trying to loosen it to make it more accessible. This is the timeline. So what's interesting here is you'll notice these are the three programs that they claim are sunsetting. Well, they're not really sunsetting. They're just coming down here and being absorbed into this program. Well, look at our timeline. We're right here. So in a couple of months, when we're in 17, we are now measuring for what your payment's going to be in 19. Let me highlight this plus or minus 4%. I'm going to talk about how that's impacted. But notice how it grows up to the 9% plus or minus. And when you add all these up, their big claim is, well, they're dropping it from 9 to 4, but they're taking it right back over the next few years as you learn how to play the game. The alternative payment model's down at the bottom. You're fine, go right ahead. This is new in the final regulations. And what they've come up with, because this was going live right away and nobody had time to react and you were going to lose 4% of your income if you didn't react well, was how to ease on down the road, as they say. So if you do nothing, which is an option, in 19 you will lose 4% of your Medicare reimbursement across the boards, because this entire program is revenue neutral. Now, the whole thing started because Congress was tired every year of fighting the lobbying efforts when they were faced with a 20 or 25% reduction in physician reimbursement, and everybody would get up in arms, and they'd give us a 1 or 2% increase, and year over year over year. So what they did was they got rid of this albatross. And they said, if we give this program and this requirement to the bureaucrats, it's out of our hands and we can't influence them. So they passed this law that goes into effect. So CMS has no choice but to start it in two and a half months. It has to start. And you'll see some numbers that I'll talk about that are still a little up in the air. But in 3 years, they're solidified because the legislation solidifies them. Little teaser. And you can see how it's going to ease on down the road, because if you do report on a limited amount of time, then you can get a little bit of an increase and they're not going to penalize you. If you are able to report for the whole year, then you're eligible for the 4% increase up to that if you're really good. Or you can go into the alternative payment model, which not many people are going to do, especially small and individual practices. Small as any is 25 or less physicians in the group. That's how they're looking at it. They do not expect small and individual practices to get into this, into the alternative payment model. So we'll talk a little bit about it, which is the decision matrix of how you get to it. Everybody here will end up in the bottom in MIPS. This is just to let you know what the advanced APMs look like. Cool, I don't have to talk anymore. Shucks. So if you get into this, the one nice thing about the alternative payment model, you get a lump sum 5% of your entire Medicare reimbursement paid to you the next year. And your increase is a little more. So that's the sweetener. But you're in risk. And if you don't do well in risk, one of the downsides to risk is your losses may more than offset the 5%. So you got, when you're in risk, you gotta be careful, really monitor what you're doing, and watch it, because that's the whole definition of risk. So what is an advanced APM? And Andy started to talk about this a little bit, and this is what they were changing today. So they've got a couple of programs for end-stage renal disease. They put them in here. Andy was talking about the Comprehensive Primary Care Plus. This changed, because this is closed right now. And what happened today is they're going to open this up again for new bids for insurance companies, because the insurance company has to agree to offer risk programs, as well as providers to get in. That care coordination fee that Andy was talking about, if you're looking at $4 per member per month, and you've got 1,000 members, you're getting that $4,000 capitated to you every month, plus all of your fee for service payments. That's the power of it, because you get that cash up front to pay for whatever infrastructure, the care coordinator you're gonna hire, the nurse navigator, help you cover the IT costs, however you wanna use it. The other thing that they're gonna do is take the next generation ACO, open that up again for 2018. Normally it's closed by now. And they expect to make the oncology care model with two-sided risk available next year at some point as an advanced APM. So they're already putting the teasers in what came out today. So what's that? Almost all of the bundled payment programs, and these are all the mandatory ones that we've got down here for hips and knees, for example, they're out. Now they're still talking about folding those back in, but for now, not yet. And as Andy pointed out, the Track 1 ACO, but this is where they're now considering a Track 1 Plus, and they're going to modify it, so more to come still on the regulations. So let's get to what we really want to talk about. Just look to Andy. This slide is unchanged from the proposed regulations. I did this on purpose because what changed is this blue line right here, this blue section of this pie, which is resource use, cost. They took out for the first year. So this pie is only divided three ways, and they made this the big section at 60% quality. Because this is all supposed to be about quality, and if you've got good quality, your cost will go down. That's the theory. What happens the second year is this is a question mark. So the measurement year 18, we don't know what cost is going to be yet as a filler here, but it's going to be in there. You'll see here, cost is 30%. That's because Congress said, this is all about cost. And so that 30% requirement is mandated by the legislature. So it literally takes an act of Congress to change that portion. So as you can see, as you're going across, here's that timeline again. The measurement period 17 starts where cost is not considered. That will affect your payment in 19. In 18, we don't know what cost is going to be, what percentage of the pie it's going to be, but that affects your payment in 20. And in 19, when you're measuring, you know cost is now going to affect 30% of your payment 2 years down the road. Andy?
Do any of you have a medical home? So one of the things that's interesting is you can get full credit for the clinical practice improvement, the red, the maroon, if you have one medical home in your town. And again, this is CMS basically saying you don't have to do the PI activities and document them if you're investing in the resources to have a medical home. And so it's these small things that happen. Is anyone here in an FQHC or RHC?
What's that?
Rural health clinic or a federally qualified health center. Okay, so they're actually immune to MIPS, so they're not held accountable for the same.
It depends. Yeah. If you go to the next slide, it explains. It depends on how you bill if you're neither of those. If you bill through the TIN of the rural health center or the federally qualified healthcare center, you're out. But if you work there and you bill under your own TIN, you're in. So you got to be careful with how the billing happens down here. Same thing for quick access hospitals for physicians that practice there. If you bill under the hospital's number, you're out. If you bill under your number, you're in. Otherwise, very few people are actually out, and most people are in. They did change this number. They made it bigger, if you can believe how little these numbers are. That was bigger than the proposed regulation. Andy? You can see I left cost in here just so you can see it doesn't count. The numbers add up correctly. This is the first year, what they're going to be measuring. So quality is 60%. Now what's nice is you don't have a whole lot that you have to measure on. And one of the things that I will go over, there are over 200 measures that you get to choose from. 80% of those measures, though, are tailored to specialists. So you've got to pick carefully what you're going to be measured on from a quality perspective so you know you do well. Remember, this is revenue neutral. Everybody's going to be ranked. Give yourself a chance to win Because if you're in the, if you're not in the top half, so if you're in the 49th percentile, you're losing income in your Medicare reimbursement. That's the big thing to keep in track in mind here. Advancing care information replaces the Medicare EHR incentive program, otherwise known as meaningful use. In the clinical practice improvement, there are over 90 activities to choose from. Some are way higher than others. So you've got to go through and pick how you want to report. The nice thing is, you know, you don't have to actually file your reports with CMS until March of 18, 417. So if you go in thinking, well, I'll do the 90 days and just get a little bit and avoid the 4%, and then your systems get in place and you've realized you don't look too bad, do the whole year. Take a shot. Because there's no negative first year. Only if you do nothing do you get hit with the full penalty. Andy? What's worse is my page is blank too. These are the categories. Remember I kept talking about how we're going to be ranked? The scoring. Peer benchmarks, not scored. Here, your own performance and your own performance. But this is 60%. You're going to be ranked against everybody else in the country. And then when the final score comes in, you're then going to be ranked for the winners and losers. And after the first year, the plus or minus is how you get ranked. So that's where, when you get a chance to pick your measures and what you're going to report on, you've got to make sure you're concentrating on what you're good at. Don't do like most of us that want to stretch and earn a little extra, so you look at what you're bad at. That's what you focus on, and you do get better, but you're still not really outstanding, don't report that. You may want to use it for your own internal measures, but keep the one that you're really outstanding.
This is where looking at your QRUR helps, because these measures are the same measures on your QRUR. If you're a small practice, you reported on 9 of them, whether you know it or not, if you're in value-based. If you're a large practice, you reported on 6 of them, plus 3 patient satisfaction from CG CAPS. And so this gives you a good sense of where you sit in terms of quality, because they're the same measures. You can actually go to qm.gov or qp.gov and actually pick your own measure sets and take a look at what they are. That just opened up in the last 2 or 3 days. You can actually browse the measure sets. Again, I think looking at your QRUR and finding out which 6 or 9 you reported on.
What does QRUR stand for again?
Quality, yeah, I just call it the QRUR, kind of like ESRD, I can't remember.
This is Quality Resource Utilization
Report. Yeah, Quality Resource Utilization Report. And like I said, when you look at the front page of the graph, you get a little, there's all sorts of blue diamonds, yellow clovers. And there's a red diamond in the middle that says you, and shows you where you are. And if you look at high quality, low cost, there's like no one there. There's like 3 groups. And if you look at them from 2013, you'll find that they were there. Everybody's kind of moved back into the mean, but there's a whole bunch of people in the low quality, low or high cost area. It's worth spending the time to look.
Now, CMS expects over 621,000 physicians to be in MIPS. So when you get ranked against your peers, there are a lot of peers you're going to be ranked against. Andy?
Do they rank regionally, or is that across the whole country?
The whole country, it's everybody. I want to emphasize that if you fall below this midpoint, you are going to lose reimbursement from Medicare. That's the whole purpose behind this slide. just emphasize, if you're falling below, you're not going to get any additional money, you're going to lose money. If you're above, you get a little bit of money. The higher graph there is where the alternative payments end up accelerating. That's the incentive they're going to have to get groups into that. And here I will turn it back over to Andy. I will return your pointer, even though you wouldn't let me play with your phone.
Can't do it. So one of the other things that's interesting about this line here is the additional adjustment factor. Is CMS has put $500 million aside for exceptional quality performance. And basically what they said is if you score the first rule, the preliminary rule said if you score 70, they moved that to 60. And so basically, if you're able to score here, you're actually eligible for the $500 million of high exceptional performance incentive for next year, if you're able to do this. So what they're doing is trying to reward people who jump in and are ready early to be able to take, and that money is shared. So if there's only one group that hits this, that one group will get $500 million. I doubt there'll be just one group, but that money gets paid out. So what do we do about this? How do you figure this out? It seems like too much, doesn't it? This isn't what I signed up for. I just want to care for patients. There are ways to figure this out in doing MIPS-type assessments. So one of the things that I want to talk a little bit about is when you look at this is our MIPS assessment. And so this is based on our assessment using the preliminary rules scoring. So we haven't had a chance to rerun this, but it looks to me that with the new rule scoring is you're going to eliminate downside and you're going to cut your upside in half. And so rather than being eligible for 4% payment, 4% penalty, you'll be eligible for no penalty and about 2% payment. So if we did nothing as our medical group, we would probably collect a whopping $8,000 in 19 for performance year 17. And part of that is where we're sitting in some of our quality scoring. What happens if we're able to capture more of the performance improvement activities and bump our quality scores? The number for us would jump to 500,000, so about 250,000 next year, 500 the year after that. What happens if we become a medical home? We have one medical home, we pick up all of the performance improvement, and we still bump our quality to 70%. We would pick up about 703,000, or 350 for next year, probably, if we were able to do this. How do you do this? The first thing that you have to do is you have to try to figure out what the stretch is, where you're at in all of it. And so what this is actually a breakdown of all of the quality measures. And for us, since we're in an ACO, we're being held accountable for all 17. That's one of the differences between being in a Track 1 ACO in MIPS or just being in MIPS alone, is that we get a composite of all 17 ACO quality scores. This is a sample of a work plan that goes all the way down to how many of these do we need to do a day to be able to achieve, to be able to get the dollars that are out there. Make sense? And I think you need that, and you need it down to essentially the physician. And so that you can look at the physician and you can say, you know what? This person's in an office by themselves. There's clearly something going on. These three are in the same office, we need to go look at these processes in this office. And so you need to be able to break this down. So as you're thinking about and thinking through MIPS, one of the things I'd ask you to think about is, what's the opportunity for you? Where are you at it? And if you're talking about looking at vendors to help you with this is from SA Ignite, the advisory board does this. There are MIPS vendors everywhere, I'm sure. Your practice managers are probably getting emails from wherever saying, we want to come talk to you about MIPS and MACRA and explain it to you and tell you what your opportunities are. If you're going to engage in those conversations, the things you want to know is, can you tell me where I'm at right now? And they're going to ask to see your 2015 QRUR, because that's where the data is to make that prediction. Can you tell me where you are right now? Can you tell me where I am right now? And can you tell me if I make no changes, what is my incentive? And I would tell you, if you look at your QRUR and you find that you're essentially at the mean, your incentive is probably going to be zero, or really close to zero, plus or minus, probably. We have what? We have 40,000 Medicare patients or something. So if you generalize that out, it's probably about $50 a patient. So if you look at your total number of Medicare patients, you're probably plus or minus $50 a patient a year, or so. And so that would be a question to ask. Then can they tell you, how do I get better? Because just telling you this is useless. They should be able to say, here's what you need to do to get better. What I need you to do is I need you to do intensive documentation of influenza. I need you to do colonoscopy and ask about colonoscopies. I need you to do mammograms. And this is how many I need you to do a day, so you can make a decision about, is it worth it to do this or not, and where you want to be for your goal. And say, I want to get to break even, I want to get to positive, I want to get the exceptional performance criteria, so that you can make a determination of what resources you need to be able to get there, and what workflows you need to change in your office. Because changing your influenza measures may be as simple as asking your MA, as they put someone in the room, of asking them where they got their influenza shot, and saying, and looking in your EHR and saying, where do I chart that so that I get credit for it? And so it's not that you have to do all of this. It's that you can help your staff, and you can help your staff focus on the right questions. So one of the things that, so I'm not nerdy enough as a nephrologist. I'm actually getting a master's in predictive analytics, which is sort of like stats plus computers plus pocket protector. And so what this looks like is, I think there's this big thing of apparent care gap. All of us know that the EHR is not designed to do quality measurement. All of us know that we're taking care of patients. And if I say that the patient got their flu shot in the EHR, in the progress note, I don't need to worry about that individual patient anymore. But to think about this in a population health level, you have to be able to get at this data. And so, you know, I'm willing to bet that if we went through your EHR and we said, send a card to everyone who it looks like in my EHR hasn't had a colonoscopy, you'd have a lot of angry patients calling you saying, I've had a colonoscopy, you set me up for it, right? I know it's in ours, I know it's a problem in ours. Same thing with flu shots. And so there are what I would call data gaps, where the data isn't in a place that we can recognize. And then there are the true care gaps, the people we forgot to talk to about their colonoscopy. Does that make sense? And so when you look at this, the problem is how your data sits in your EHR. There's what's called structured data, and that is, think of that as an Excel spreadsheet. If I want to know influenza, the number of patients who should be measured for influenza, I go to G4. And if I want to know the number of patients I gave influenza to, the vaccine to, I go to G3. And then I divide G3 by G4 and G5, and that gives me my G. I'm confused. Question. What it tells you is that can be found and reported. Quality workflows in your EHR usually are fairly different than clinical workflows, though. And so there's stuff that's missing from here. This is CQMs, labs, vitals, problem lists. This is numeric data. Then there's this other place we talked about. This is why I talked about being in a track one ACO, is you get these adjudicated claims. These adjudicated claims are full of quality data. How many of your hemoglobin A1Cs do you actually transcribe from the lab PDF and put in your EHR as discrete numbers? A few? Well, if you don't, and you just scan them as PDFs, you don't know what their hemoglobin A1C is. If you're getting claims back, at least you know you've done a hemoglobin A1C because there's a bill for it. And so you may get credit for ordering the hemoglobin A1Cs by looking at these fully adjudicated claims. Or if a mammogram shows up on the claim, you know that that's a mammogram that's been done, as opposed to a PDF of a mammogram report that's been scanned to you that you scanned into your EHR. And so using these claims can also help you with that. And then there's this unstructured data, which is your texts, the PDFs, notes, scan labs, all the stuff that you don't really enter in deliberately. Mm-hmm. There are ways that you can capture this. And so what this is the medical group's approach to this. And so we have CQM as Crimson Quality Manager. And so all of the structured EHR data goes through here. We have something called Crimson Population Risk Manager for all of our fully adjudicated claims, which is through PSIN, because we're a member of PSIN in the ACO, so that they're doing our population health. We have all that data here. And then what I have over here is something called NLP, that's natural language processing, that's machine learning, and the goal of that is to actually mine the data out of your unstructured data that you have set up. And so what that looks like is, this is us doing a demo of this, where we took 21 patients and said, let's take a look at four measures: colonoscopy, mammogram, influenza, pneumonia. So it's a proof of concept. And we said, let's see if we have eligible and what kind of gaps we found. We took 668 PDF files, office visits. So we turned our office visits into PDFs, nursing home communication follow-up, CMPs that hadn't been entered, acute visits, nurses' notes, navigators, diagnostic results. And looking at that, we said of the 668, we think 380 of them probably contain some kind of data that we'd be interested in. And then what we did is we did OCR, optical character recognition, text recognition, and we turned them into a readable file. And so what happens, it looks like this. And then we use machine learning, and so I worked with a group from India. And it's very interesting, one, the time difference is, so I'm talking to these folks at 5 to 6 in the morning, 10 to 11 o'clock at night, and I'm hearing elephants. What is that? He's like, that's an elephant. I'm like, no, really, what is that? And so what they did is they went through, and this is an example of influenza, is saying we're looking to fill our care gap for influenza in 2015. And so they had to be immunized within October of 2014 to February of 2015. That's the influenza season that counts for the 2015 influenza season. This patient had influenza on October 6th, 2014, and so was flagged as filling the care gap. So this patient would then go back, and we would then flag that and chart that as an influenza. If you change this date and eliminate this, they go away. They say, this is someone you need to do influenza. So what this is doing is turning all of your progress notes, where you're actually putting all of your thinking and your data, and turning it into something that's usable. And there are companies out there that are doing NLP. You don't have to talk about CareCentra. You don't have to. There's 50 or 100 of them out there that are talking about doing natural language processing. And all of your notes have to be turned into PDFs because of meaningful use. So they're able to be turned into PDFs. You're able to talk about someone doing this with NLP, and then you're able to hopefully get some credit for this. What we found here is, in this relatively small sample, we improved our measure by about 15% by just going through these notes and finding those care gaps. The other thing that was interesting when we did this with colonoscopy is we happened to find one guy who had a colectomy. And so we were able to exclude him from the denominator by doing the natural language processing, because I think I'd be pretty angry if I had my colon taken out and I got a reminder every year to get a colonoscopy because I hadn't had one yet. And so being able to find that and do that is something that's very possible. And so again, what this begins to do is the computer doesn't like it when the projector doesn't like it, just move on the trackpad. There we go. And so what we're able to do is take these data gaps and close them by using the claims and the natural text and say, let's concentrate on our true care gaps. I think that's pretty cool. I'm nerdy, but I think that's pretty cool, because one of the reasons no one has ever used the EHR to do population health is everyone knows that the data in the EHR doesn't actually represent the real state of how we're taking care of our patients. And so there are ways to be able to do this and put this together in a meta EHR. And the reason I think this is important is if you look at some of the work plan here, there was like, we had to do like 64 pneumonia shots a day. We had to go through and document those. That's a full-time FTE. If you spend all the time to look at them up, call the patient. You know, there's actually a really interesting Medicare program that's used on the billing side called Connects. Ever heard of it? Connects actually has all that data in it, and you can actually log in to find out when their last colonoscopy was. We have our nurses who are doing our wellness visits logging into Connects to fill out those care gaps for the patients, because it's all in there. And patients, you know, can you remember when you had your colonoscopy? Can you remember when you had your flu shot? Can you remember when you had your pneumonia vaccine? Those are things that the patients can't remember, and it's really cool for them when they come in and say, this is when all this happened. They're like, great, and we hand them a scorecard when they leave so that they know when all this has happened. It also closes those gaps for us to say, we don't have to go after all those extra data to close those gaps. And so it makes this much more reasonable to be able to close those care gaps going forward. Because what you've done is say, let's focus on our true care gaps rather than the wasted time of closing data gaps. I'd really like to talk to you about that, but save that for another time. So the entire point of this is if you take something away from us, one, MIPS isn't going to go away. MIPS, you know, everyone talks about, well, the ACA is going to get repealed. In my MIPS was approved 92-8% bipartisan. It's not going away. MIPS is what's driving this. It's not going to get repealed because no one wants to go back to the SJR. Even if the ACA suddenly disappeared tomorrow, we're still heading values for you. There's opportunities here if you're willing to take the time to look at it. What is one big opportunity? Talking about positioning yourself to get into Medicare Advantage risk and looking at maximizing RAF and HCC and then sharing risk because you have the dollars to actually do what you need to do for your patients. So look at your QRUR. Think about HCCs and then begin thinking about your strategy for MIPS. What do you want to do? How do you want to partner? Do you want to do this yourself? Do you want to say, I'm going to look at my QRUR and I think I have just a few Medicare patients and I can go ahead and do a blitzkrieg on my six quality measures that I'm going to report? Or do you say, you know what, I'm only going to report one quality measure this year, avoid the payment penalty, and I'm going to take this year to assess this and ramp up. I think that's a reasonable strategy. That's strategy one, is saying, okay, I'm going to report one measure, one time, avoid the penalty, figure out what I'm doing going forward. What I wouldn't do is I wouldn't take 2017 off and report one measure, and then in 2018 begin preparing for what it is you're going to do for 2018, because you won't make it. It's too much to do going forward. This is why the government backed off of going full steam 2017. They're not likely to say, well, we're going to back off going full steam in 2018. They may go halfway to what 18 looks like. And so I'm happy I'll stop there, and Dan and I are happy to take any questions.
What was the website where we would find the QR?
I think it is qp.gov.
If you just Google QRUR, you'll find it.
Yeah, and so the QRUR is also through QualityNet. So if you do QualityNet, and so you have to have a CMS Enterprise account. You may actually have one, but not know it. Why? Because I'm willing to bet you're all registered payers with Medicare, right? If you are, you probably already have all that data. I'm also willing to bet you're sending PQRS numbers. So I'm willing to bet your office manager, this is something your office staff has taken care of for you and never told you about because they've never really seen any value in bothering you. Maybe not, maybe. And so I would go get that. Those are once you get access, you get approved, it can be downloaded, and it's downloaded as a PDF, and take a look at it.
on your slide where everything is going, across, you end with the Medicare Advantage plans, which we've been doing through an organization that we're in. But I don't remember ever hearing that they actually felt like they did save money or that it was really working. Do they feel that it is really working?
So the government now believes, so when Obama came in, became president, he wanted to get rid of Medicare Advantage. He did not believe that there was any value to continue. What he's found, and what Andy Slavitt has found, is that this is a great way to get people to share risk. Because not only do you share risk, but you actually get more dollars for the sicker your patient is to be able to put those resources behind. And I would say that a lot of those places, a lot of places who are doing MA and doing it well, they're making more in MA than they're making in fee-for-service.
The reason Obama wanted to get rid of it was the insurance companies learned early on, if you raise the severity score, they get more money. So they started having you do all these enhanced encounters. Not telling you that if you were taking risk, you'd get more money, but so they could get more money. And so one of the things that Obama was looking at when he came on board was the cost for Medicare Advantage kept going up. Now they bid below the expense, but then when the severity goes up, they end up getting more money. The plans that are now sharing risk are going to be in those advanced payment models and are allowing you now, when you do those enhanced encounters or send that information to them for the physician groups that have now learned that instead of doing that big form, that they just capture all the information naturally in their EHR, they can ship it, thus saving the time of filling out those multi-page documents. You can get more money. Same thing, but now they're starting to share it.
But like we do ours through an IPO, and so that's not really, it has to be an
ACO. It's going to the IPO, and then it gets diffused. So you may be doing real well.
Yeah. But I mean, going forward, the IPOs is a part of this. It has to be an ACO.
Medicare Advantage, Medicare Advantage patients are not in an ACO. They're carved out. And so, so you can do this in any type of arrangement. You just want to make sure that you're... that if your IPO is risk sharing, that you're seeing what your RAF scores are and what you're doing for, and what you're getting back for the risk, rather than just getting quality bonuses paid. Because this can be very lucrative. So a tenth of a point of RAF for 1,000 members is $1 million a year.
Yeah, we figured that out.
But then they keep changing the rules on what counts to
they do, and what the government also is now starting in 18 or 17 is going to require 10% of your RAF score to be transmitted directly from the provider rather than through the insurance company. And that number will go up every year thereafter. And the reason is exactly what Dan said, is the enhanced encounter rigmarole is one of the ways that they feel the insurance potentially gaming the system, and they want to actually see that the provider is doing something with that data. And so you'll see more and more of the push to make sure the documentation is contained in your EHR. So I think 2019 or 2020, it jumps up to 75% of the data needs to be transmitted from the EHR rather than from the insurance company.
And that's where CMS expects the individual small group won't do it.
It isn't this all sort of, the end game is individual doctors are, they're not going to be able to do this.
Well, CMS has been pushing for a consolidation amongst all healthcare providers, hospitals into systems, physicians into large multi-specialty group practices for almost 20 years. It started out subtle, but the Bushes started this push. The Clintons were doing it too a little bit.
But the data doesn't show they provide better care. The data shows that individual doctors provide better care for their individual patients than groups do.
But the issue to CMS is a fiscal issue, because that's what Congress is dealing with. It's a budgetary issue. You've got finite money coming in. How do you manage the bolus of baby boomers who are coming into this system today and will continue to come into it for another 15 years or more.
I agree with your statement about the data. That is in doctors who are actually actively managing outcomes. There is data also that shows that individual practices with small, small physician components also perform worse if they're not engaged in the outcome, managing the outcome. So a two-person practice who has a medical home has much better outcomes than a 100-group doc who had a medical home. But that doesn't mean that a two-doc practice who's still on paper or who is just doing
the
EHR.
Yeah, I get what you're saying. I'm not saying that's what I'm saying.
But I would also say is that that's part of the reason that the system has asked us to come out and talk about this is because I don't know that we're saying join. What I'm saying is let's figure out how to leverage the things that we're doing or that you can do with other places, and so that you're educated when you begin having those conversations rather than just saying, look, I gotta sell my practice because I can't do this, is to give you the vocabulary to have a conversation and say, you know what, I think I want to align with you, and what I need from you is help here. How can you help me here and allow me to stay independent? And I think that's something that can that's a powerful, it's an and. It's, you're right, you don't have the IT staff and expertise to maybe do this, but maybe there's a way that you can work with a group that you feel more aligned with to say, let's have a conversation about how we do this and how we can do this together. And so maybe I purchase population health services from you by being in your ACO and you help me do all these things together. And so that's what I think is a way to stay independent and still be able to care for your patients and create your own direction. But if you don't know the language to have the conversation, then it just feels overwhelming.
So I'm in the, I don't have the language to have the conversation, I'm feeling overwhelmed. Right now. So I don't know what you would suggest for somebody like self who's in a two-physician practice that's independent. I mean, I'll go to qp.gov and look at that, but you know, I don't have any idea what to do next year, how to sign up for what or what. I don't have a practice manager. It's me and my partner.
Yeah. So the first place I'd start is I start at qp.gov, and the reason is that macro from the government website is broken down into bite-sized chunks that you can take a look at. The infographics are pretty nice. You can take a look at your quality stuff. Then, so qp.gov is where the quality is. QualityNet is where your QRUR is, so, which is through the CMS Enterprise login. And so, but what I would tell you is, if you're overwhelmed, we'll walk you through the steps. Let us know. We'll talk about it. We'll say, here's what you need to do. We can't do those places, so we can say, here's what you need to do. 3 years ago, 2.5 years ago, we came to the medical group. We had to do all this too. And so, you know, we weren't talking about QRURs in September of 14. But that became part of our language. We weren't talking about HCCs until, you know, middle of 2015. And so we've been through that journey. And so, let's talk it out. I want people out there providing care to patients. I don't want people throwing in the towel and retiring because folks need our help. Let's figure it out.
Is there a place for PSIN to help with this?
So I want to make sure it's neutral. PSIN is HSHS.
Right.
I would tell you that Jim Bach, who is the CMO of PSIN, and Tom Appel know about this. And if you look at the slides that Dan was using, the PSIN board presentation about how to do this. So, yes. And organizations like PSIN. And again, the purpose of this conversation is to say, if you want to go talk with PSIN about it, here are the questions to ask. And here's what happens. You get in the ACO, suddenly, I'm the quality officer for the ACO as well, suddenly it's my job to make sure your quality is good, which is MIPS. And so you win because I'm trying to improve your quality and provide you resources with. And it's going to be the same with other places too. Is that that's the entire goal? Is by getting in this, you get data, you get to see this, and you get the help and support. So I think that integrated networks can provide you those resources. It's not the only place. You can do it on your own. And I don't want to say, what I don't want this to be is a commercial for HSHS. What I want it to be is, there are ways you can do this on your own. We want to give you the resources to do it on your own. There are ways to say, here's how you can partner and stay independent. And then there are the other ways that you may say, someone else to worry about all of these things. And so yes, PSIN and other organizations like that very much would be willing.
So our practice is in PSIN. So then the quality data and the metrics and, you know, the little dashboard things that we see on our information, how can we translate that to, or can we translate that data?
Are you in the ACO? What's your practice?
Aaron
Fancher,
AVN.
I don't think you are. So one of the questions is, I'm in PSIN too, but I'm not in the ACO. One of the things that we've let Tom and Jim know is, as we come out and talk about this, is this is the next conversation, is how can PSIN help? And we want to.
Well, because I see it as a natural transition. You're already collecting this data, yes, or helping us collect this data. Yes. So then where do we go? And like when you were talking about the data collection stuff, I mean, with American Academy of Family Practice, I did a PQRS thing through them that was like a TurboTax for PQRS, you know? And so they would tell you what you were good at based on what you saw all the time. And then it was, which quality measures do you want to measure for this year and next year? And then you enter the data and they magically make it go to the government. So.
So what I'll say is, one of the things that will come out of this discussion is PSIN needs to do this more. We had an in-depth discussion at the board retreat about this, about what they need to do, because everyone needs to understand the rule to be able to implement it. And we're beginning to talk about that. So yes, I would expect that PSIN and other integration, physician integration organizations should be able to help. The board's now getting up on that quality committee. The board says, well, let's hear more about this and how we can do this. You know, we're talking about how we can use NLP in a bigger, expanded way. We're actually in active discussions about how to expand the NLP. We're in active discussions about Crimson Population Risk Manager and how we can feed into CQR. So we are doing those things, because they're the things that need to happen for all physicians to be successful.
Yeah, I read an article, I think it was in USA Today last week. They were talking about, there was an article about macro MIPS, and they were saying that, you know, family primary care doctors in the U.S., you know, they said that like 35% of them were going to stop seeing Medicare patients because of this model, and what that was going to do, you know, to the healthcare system. So, you know, so for us, you know, I read that and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, that's an awful lot of years of good life being given up by doctors over bureaucracy, but it's like everything else, you kind of have to play the game sometimes to do it. So. I'm sure there will be some of it.
Again, we're finding things as we go through the validation for CQR about logic, about measure logic, that's changing some of the things that we're looking at and importance. And if, you know, for example, our influenza measure is pointed at date entered rather than date delivered. We need to change that because we went back and retroactively entered some flu vaccines over the summer and we didn't get credit for those. And so it's spending the time to make sure. You know, the Allscripts CQM module is very interesting. Is your colonoscopy rates will be tremendous if you do urine dips in your office and enter them. Why? Because the Allscripts CQM logic actually gives you credit for urine hemoglobin. We actually found that because one of our urologists has the highest colonoscopy rate in the medical group. And we're like, what are you doing to these people in offices?
Really, but you missed the measure by about that much, maybe?
It's making sure as you go through this, spending the time validating that data. Because it changes our opinion. One of our things we found in Allscripts as we've been going through the validation of the data is our logic is giving us credit for our hemoglobin A1Cs from 2 years in the past, which is not the measure logic. So our diabetes control isn't as good as we think it is. And so we're working through that and saying, well, maybe we need to spend time and energy looking at it. And if you don't have, you should be part of an organization that's spending the time to validate the data as it goes forward, because You know, we've had several conversations with Allscripts and Crimson that we've been the first ones to find errors in their logic that have affected everyone who's been in it. And it's because no one's actually spent the time to look at the data like this before. But now, it's really critical to do that. But you're not alone. That's the key. That's the thing I want you to come out of this. You're not alone. There are people out there who want to help, who want providers to stay independent, who want you to be able to do the things you want to do and provide you the thought about this. And there's hope. There's a track to the future to allow you. I didn't go to medical school to do fee-for-service medicine. I don't think any of us did, because there are perverse incentives in fee-for-service medicine. All of us know it. It's the dirty secret of medicine that's now being recorded for everyone in the world to hear, but there are perverse incentives in it. This is the closest, the MA piece with HCCs is the closest I've come to saying, look, I'm now getting paid to spend an hour with the patient who needs to spend an hour with me. And now I don't have to worry and be happy that I have an otitis media and a sore throat between my two 80-year-olds with 9 medical problems with med-med interactions that I have exactly the same amount of time to take care of. It's like, now I've got more time to take care of them because I'm getting the dollars and resources to spend the time with them I should. And so there is hope at the end of this to say there's the opportunity to do this. If we don't engage with this, people are going to do it anyway. It's let's engage and change the course and have a real discussion about what that looks like going forward. You know, the HCC model only predicts 12% of people's real risk. We should be engaging actively with Medicare to say we need a better model to look at that. And that's the point, is if we don't play it.
Someone on the side for us.
It's going to be a tough one. You know,
that's how we got this way. We didn't step up when we had the chance.
And you know, one of the ways I look at this is, I don't mind playing basketball. I love to double dribble, and I love to travel. It's a lot easier if I double dribble and travel in basketball. I can get to the hoop a lot easier and shoot. The problem is when I sign on to play basketball, I have to understand the rules of the game. And I'm willing to bet that there are those in this room who can tell me the difference between college basketball rules and NBA rules, and tell me the difference between college football rules and NFL rules regarding the number of feet that need to be in for receptions, regarding how you catch, regarding whether the time clock runs, right? It's the same thing here. It's just that this isn't as interesting, potentially, as understanding that you can have 1 foot down in college football and you have to have 2 feet down in the NFL. It's the same thing. If you know the rules, you can play the game. And what we're trying to do here is say, here are the rules. And the game is subtly changing. Spend the time, learn the rules.
I mean, there's no doubt. I mean, these things, we've all wished for, you know, Pop Health and stuff to be part of that. We got something got paid for, instead of when we touch the doorknob, that's when the patient usually, oh yeah, should I be on a diet? You know, we would get into that after we talked about their sinusitis as you're leaving. It was an oh by the way thing. Yeah, that was always it. Now at least they're paying for, you know, welcome Medicare exams. They're paying for some of the wellness stuff, and I just kind of look at. You know, at this, we always said, well, we should be paid for what we do. Our sicker patients, we ought to get paid more for that. And, you know, this is putting a real pinch on all employed physician groups like ours, because how do you justify the use of a nurse practitioner in an office that could come in and get the same number of RVUs as a really comprehensive case like this? So we're trying to look at this saying, you know, if a doc is spending a lot more time building HCCs and RAF scores, should they be paid more for that than the sore throat, you know? And it's really causing problems for, you know, compensation models across the country. So we're looking at that now too. How do we comp the docs for the right, you know, for doing all that extra work, taking care of sick people?
Other questions, discussion?
Thank you.
Too much.
Everybody depressed now.
So I'll make sure your comments get back to Peason. So we'll make sure. I'll also ask that Peason address that in the newsletter. I think that's great feedback. And I said we'll make sure that you get the, I'll send the PDFs, we'll take out the medical group dollars. I don't really want that in print running around everywhere. But we'll have that, you know, Bob, Jim, they know how to get in touch with us. I want doctors, I want nurse practitioners, I want PAs to succeed in taking care of patients. We need you. And I don't want people to get discouraged, so we'll help the best we can. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.